Hello everyone. So in the last video, we have performed the pre-layout simulation of a CMOS inverter, right, in electric. And today we are going to do it for the layout. We have to going to build a layout and do its post-layout simulation. Okay. So for making the layout, what we need to do is we need to go to the library. This is the library. And over here, we right click on the library. And we click on create a new cell. So in this, we have to give the same name as we have given to the schematic. So schematic, we have given the name INV, that is inverter. So here also we have to give the same name. And from here view, we have to click on the layout and then click on OK. So once you do that, now you see over here, there are two cells now. There are two views basically, right? So one is the schematic view and one is the layout view. So when you click on the schematic view, this has already been completed before. And the layout view, we will be building up the layout for the CMOS inverter over here. Fine. Now, you know, we have same cell over here inverter, and we have two views, correct? One is the schematic and one is the layout view, as we have already discussed. This is the schematic view and this is the layout view. Both the views have different component list. So let's go into the schematic view and check its component. So their component list is different. Now, again, if we go to the layout and go to the components, their component list is different over here. Okay, so that's how we differentiate between them. So now, without further delay, let us begin with the layout. Okay, so in the layout view, what you can do is we can turn it on. So you can turn on the grid either by pressing Ctrl G. So I press Ctrl G. Or you can turn on the grid by going to Windows and over here press click on toggle grid. Okay, fine. So now we'll begin the process with your, now we have a CMOS inverter, right? So CMOS inverter contains a NMOS transistor at the bottom and a PMOS transistor at the top, correct? So let's begin with the PMOS transistor. So you have to go to the components and we have to select the PMOS transistor here. So if you click over here, below you get a node, below you get a description of it. P transistor, right? Here it is N transistor, correct? And the scale and the foundry is also given. So see below, extremely bottom, right? So we'll click on the PMOS and left click on the PMOS and we keep it over here. And we place it onto the main screen and we do it like this. So now our PMOS has got selected and it's got it placed onto the screen. Okay, so now basically let me expand it a little. This is how a PMOS transistor in layout looks like. It represented by different layers. So basically your green color is my active layer. My active layer is the P-type silicon, right? My pink color is my polysilicon layer, right? And the outer, you know, we have this outer region, outer shaded gray region represents a box, which is representing a well. And the inner light yellow represents the oxide select. So you see there are four colors over here. Green represents the active region. Then pink represents the polysilicon, which is the gate material. And the outer shaded gray color box represents the well. And the inner light yellow box represents the oxide select. Okay, so these are the various colors. Now what we need to do is, over here, we need to rotate it. Now, why we need to rotate this is reason being that we want our polysilicon layer to be running vertically in the vertical direction. So to rotate and also to select the transistor sizing, we have to double click over here. Okay. So when you double click over here in the node properties, you can define the width, the length and the rotation, right? So let's check out what is the transistor sizing for PMOS. So for a PMOS, the width of the PMOS is 10 lambda and the length is 2 lambda over here given, right? So we'll keep it the same. So when we go into the layout, this is my PMOS transistor. I will double click over here. I will keep the width of the PMOS transistor as 10 lambda and the length is 2. And rotation, I have to rotate it 90 degrees. So I'll put the rotation as 90. And then I click on OK. So when you do that, the transistor sizing now, the width of the transistor is 10 lambda, right? 1 lambda is 100 nanometer over here. So basically, your length also will be 2 lambda. So basically 200 nanometer, right? And we have rotated at 90 degree. As you can see, the polysilicon line is coming vertically now. So that is what we want. And for every step, if you all can, have a clear-cut distinction, key what is going on exactly. So you have to understood up till here what we have done. So I'll repeat once. We have selected a PMOS transistor and we have rotated the PMOS transistor and we have done the transistor sizing for it. So width is 10 lambda, length is 2 lambda. So that is what we have done so far. Fine. So remember one more thing. In electric, especially in electric, the active region of NMOS and PMOS is represented by the green color. Okay, there is no distinction over here. The distinction between them is made by the pattern of the shape. So you see over here, the outer, outer box pattern is different. For a NMOS, it will be different. So whenever we select a NMOS transistor, we will come back to it. Fine. So next we have to place contacts, right? So because active region will consist of your this light pink color is my gate region, right? And then we have the source and the drain. So we have to define the source and the drain contacts now. So for that, we have to go over here. Here you see, if you come over here, here you see this is the P active contact. Okay, downstairs the description is given. If you select this, the description is given as metal one to P active contact. Okay, it's a metal one to P active contact. So this we have to left click over here and right click and place it onto the left hand side. Okay, so this is my metal one to P active contact, right? So now we have to connect them over here, right? So I will left click over here and I'll right click over here so that they're connected together. Yeah. So they have connected together over here, right? Just like connecting a wire, right? Now what I can do is I can select this and next I can use the keyboard arrow, up arrow, down, left and right. So I can use left and right arrow. I can move up and down. And you can move it inside it. Okay. So this we will do it later. But first we will check that the sizing over here is not proper. So what we will do is of the contact. So we'll double click over here. Basically, we have the width as 10. So here also we'll keep the y-axis as 10 lambda. Okay. So now it is proper. Now we have selected it to be 10 lambda. So your contact gets connected. So we can left click on the contact, okay, and we can adjust to the right, left, up, down with the arrow key on the keyboard, and we can bring it as close to the PMOS as possible. So notice that as you bring it to the close, at this point of time, we shall run the design rule check, or we call it DRC. So how do we check DRC? You go to tools and you select DRC and click on check hierarchy. So when you do that, it's showing two errors. Found two errors. Let us check it out. What are those errors, right? So how to check the errors? You go to Explorer, you click on errors, and over here, it will show you some errors. Okay. So here it is. These are the errors which are coming up. So what is this error? We look into it now carefully. So maybe I will push this outside first. And again, check the DRC. Yeah, so no errors are found right now. There are no errors which are found right now. So we have to, keep doing this. I will select this and then I will push it inside and as close as possible, right? We have to save silicon space. And now if I go to tools and click on check hierarchy, it's showing no errors or warnings found, right? So there are absolutely no errors right now and we can proceed very, very safely. So we have made one of the contacts over here this way. Similarly, what we need to do is we will again go over here And now we will place the contacts. So we have to run this DRC as frequently as we can. Else the errors will get accumulated. So next we select the P-active contact over here again and attach it to the right side of the PMOS to form another contact. Maybe source or drain, we will decide that. So again, we have to double click on the contact, make the Y size as 10 and then click on OK. And then we will right click over here. Left click on the contact, then right click over here. So the contact is made now. And now we have to move it nearby with the arrow key, left arrow key. And now again, keep on checking the DRC at every step. So again, we'll go to DRC and click over here. Again, it's showing no errors found, as you can see very, very clearly. Okay. So no errors or warnings are found. Fine. So so far what we have completed is we have aligned the source and the drain contact for PMOS. So one of them is source, one of them is drain. So it depends upon which one we connected to the VDD, that becomes the source for a PMOS transistor. Okay, so we have successfully completed the PMOS transistor contact. Now, next is we can slightly minimize this. Okay, with the mouse pad over here, or else we can scroll it so that it will get minimized, or you can minimize it from here. Okay, zoom out or zoom in. Okay, control 0 or control 7, we can do that. Fine. Next is we have to now NVEL contact is selected. Now we have to have your NVEL contact. So here it is NVEL, right? So why we select NVEL? Because PMOS, which have a P, it has a, you know, a PMOS transistor have to have made inside the NVEL. Fine. So we will select the NVEL contact from here. As you can see, it's a metal 1 to NVEL contact. And we paste it on the top of your PMOS transistor. Let's see over here. Okay. Now, since your PMOS are formed in NVEL, right? So we'll bring NVEL over the top of PMOS as we have done over here. Next, we extend this NVEL horizontally with X size as 18. Let's see that. So we have double clicked over here. X size can make it around, let's say, first of all, 15. So yeah, we can slightly extend it more, let's say to 18. So that it covers the entire area over here, horizontally, right? And now what we can do is we can bring the NVEL contact close to your PMOS transistor from the top without violating any DRC. So let me check the DRC now again. So it is again showing 5 errors. So let me see what are those errors. Okay, so their distance have to be maintained. There is a minimum distance, so we have to maintain that. So I bring it closer now. And now if I again check the DRC, it's showing 0 errors, no errors or warnings found. So it's everything fine. We have to keep on checking that there are certain design rules. I guess, I think it will be covered in your theory. So for the layouts, right? There are certain design rules between the different layers. So you have to follow that at least. Now, your NVEL contact has a metal one running over here. You see over here, this is the metal one running over the NVEL contact. So we can left click on the source contact. So let's say if we consider this is my source contact. Okay. And so we can left click on the source contact, metal one contact. And then we will right click towards the NVEL contact. So here the connection has been made. Metal is your light blue color. Fine. So what have we done over here is we have connected my source contact to the NVEL contact. Okay, then we can click over here and bring it nearby and check the DRC if there are any errors found. Yeah, there are no errors still. So you can bring it as close as we want. So let's say over here right now we check for again DRC. So it's not showing any errors. So let's do that. So what we have done so far is we have sized the PMOS transistor. And we have defined this is definitely the source contact, because a source of a PMOS transistor is connected to VDD. So this will become later my supply, power supply VDD, right? So next we'll assign the SPICE model to the PMOS transistor. It should tell now which it's a PMOS transistor, right? Because we have selected over here the TSMC 180 nanometer model cut. So over here we have defined a SPICE model as PMOS and NMOS. The naming has to be exact as this. So what we will do is we have to select this active region over here, right? And then we have to go to tools, go to simulation SPICE, and click on set SPICE model. So once you click over here, now we can expand this part. Okay. So we have to somehow replace this SPICE model name. We have to replace it with PMOS. So what we do is we maximize, keep on maximizing. If you see carefully, it's difficult to have the selection. It's very difficult to select this text SPICE model. So solution is to maximize that portion of the layout, right? And to select the SPICE model or to edit it, you press the control button. So then one by one, every layer will get selected. So I press the control button now. So my text is selected. I can drag it out. So once I have dragged it out, I can double click over here and I can enter a name as PMOS. Okay, same name as PMOS. And then I'll enter. And now you can bring it back. So in this way, you have to enter your SPICE model name. I hope it is clear, right? So your model is got selected and we have double clicked over it and entered the PMOS successfully. Now, if I zoom out or if I go to Windows and fill window, so in your front of your screens, you see a PMOS transistor. We have already defined its sizing. Their contacts are connected and we have also connected the NVL contact, right? And also defined the SPICE model for the active transistor, that is PMOS transistor. So now what we need to do is we need to slightly minimize it. And similarly, we have to do it for the NMOS transistor, right? So let's go to the NMOS transistor now. So for the NMOS transistor, again, we have to go to components and select NMOS and place it onto the schematic. I'm in the screen. So here my NMOS transistor is selected. Let me just maximize this portion now. So as you can see, what's the difference between NMOS and PMOS? The pattern of the outer gray box is different, right? The active layer is same green color, but the pattern over here is different. Okay, if I expand it and show it to here, this is PMOS for PMOS outer gray box, right? And this is my NMOS, right? So again, for the NMOS, what we need to do is we need to size it properly. This is my NMOS transistor. So let me go to the inverter schematic and check the sizing. The width is 5 lambda and the length is 2 lambda. So we'll go to the layout and we'll maximize that part from over here. First, let us check the DRC. So DRC is not giving any errors. So it's absolutely fine, right? Now what we will do is we will double click over here and select the width as 5 lambda. Okay. We'll select the width as 5 lambda. The length is 2 lambda. And also this also we have to rotate it 90 degrees, right? So we'll enter over here 90 and then click on OK. Fine. So what has happened is we have sized the transistors. We have selected the width and the length, same as the inverter width and length. Over here, given in the schematic. In the inverter layout also, we have done that. And also we have rotated it 90 degree so that the polysilicon, that is light pink color layer, is coming vertically. And it's easier to connect them this way. Correct? Now let me maximize that portion over here. Okay. So as I've already told you that the outer layer, the outer box, gray color box, is pattern is different as compared to the PMOS. So that's why we distinguish between your NMOS and your PMOS transistor in electric. So next, we have already rotated it and sized it. We will add an active contact on both the sides. Okay. So we'll again go to components. Earlier for the PMOS, we have added P active contact. For the NMOS, we will add an active contact. So this is nothing but your metal one to N active contact. Okay. So what we will do is we'll place this contact on the left hand side over here. And then what we need to do is we'll left click on the contact and right click over here so that they are connected. And now we can bring them together as close as possible. Okay, without violating any rule. So again, we'll go to tools, go to DRC and check the hierarchy. So there are no errors or warnings found, right? So here there is no need of selecting the width of the contact because they are exactly fitting each other. Fine. So here the contact is made. Now it's a source or a drain that will decide where it is connected to. If the contact is connected, if the NMOS contact, either source or drain, is connected to the ground, that is the source contact. Fine. So we have added, we have checked it, and we have checked there are no DRC errors. Similarly, we will add this N plus active contact to the right hand side over here. Correct. And here we will left click and we'll right click over here. Correct. So the connection is made now, and we will use the arrow key and move it near the active layer, right? And then again we check the DRC errors. So DRC, we'll click on spice hierarchy. Correct. And again we found no errors at all. So that means whatever we have done, that is the layout for the NMOS and PMOS, it's perfectly fine, well within the rules. Within the design, it has not violated any design. So next step is to add the spice model for the NMOS transistor. So we select this, we'll go to tools, and we'll go to spice simulation, and we'll write set spice model. So as you can see, the spice model is got added. So now it's not get selected. So we'll maximize this part. We'll press the control. One by one, the layers are getting selected. We'll move it out. And here we can select the name as NMOS. Okay. So the NMOS layer is got selected, and then we can bring it back over here. Right. So this way we can select the NMOS. Why the name NMOS? Because in the CMOS inverter schematic also, we have named this model as NMOS and PMOS. Okay. So similarly for the layout also, we have named over here. Let me maximize this part. Let me minimize this and maximize this part. So here we have selected the spice model correctly as NMOS, right? And now we have to add a P-well contact because the NMOS is made inside a P-well contact. So again, we'll go to components and select the P-well layer over here. This is your metal one to P-well contact. So we can place it at the bottom of your NMOS transistor, right? So this is my contact. That is your P-well contact. Now, what we need to do is we need to again double click on this contact, and horizontally X size we have to select it as 18 lambda, as we have done earlier for the N-well contact, right? So here it is vertically, horizontally selected. So it's covering the area, right? And now you see over here that these are small grids, small dots. So the difference between this dot is 1 lambda. And there are some darker grids, sizing 10 lambda. So we need to connect. This is just for the information, just that if you want to count how much is the space over here. Yeah, we can count it by this manner, that smaller grid distance is smaller grid, that is dots. Distance is 1 lambda, and the darker ones have 10 lambda distance, right? So now we have to connect the source contact with the P-well contact. So let's say that, let me just slightly zoom out. Okay. So I have to, let's say this is my source contact, and this source contact I have to connect it to my, this thing, my P-well, right? So what I will do is I will left click over here and I will right click over here. So they are connected now. See, it's connected with a light blue. So that's the metal one layer. Now we can check the DRC. Check the DRC at every step. So there are no errors getting accumulated. So now there are no errors. So we can bring this P-well contact to as close as possible. Now again, check for DRC, whether it's not violating any rule. No, it's not violating. So it's perfectly fine. So now we have defined the source contact with the P-well metal contact, right? With the zero DRC errors. Fine. So next, what we can do is we have to align the polysilicon and NMOS and PMOS and connect them together. So what I will do is I'll zoom out a little so that I can see. Now you can see carefully. I have to zoom out a little more. So I'll go to the windows and click on fill window. So now the entire, contacts along with the PMOS and the NMOS transistor. So above is my PMOS transistor and below is my NMOS transistor. Let me slightly maximize it. And yeah, so this is my PMOS and this is my NMOS. And now I have to connect their, the polysilicon layers together. That is the gate terminals, right? So we have to bring out the contacts. So what we need to do is we need to bring it. What we can do is we can zoom out and we can bring this layer. So we can select this entire layer and you can move it up with the help of the up arrow key in your mouse keyboard. So we can go to tools and check the hierarchy. There are three errors. So maybe we have exceeded, violated some error. So we can go back, go down a bit. So now there are no errors. So now they are perfectly fitted. We have aligned it and we have brought it as near as possible. Now we have to connect the two polysilicon layers. So we can right click over here and left click over here. Now the polysilicon layer is connected. Now we have to add the metal one to the polysilicon contact. Metal one to polysilicon contact. So over here we have the metal one to polysilicon contact. So this we can left click and we can place it over here. Right. So this is my metal one to polysilicon contact. I need to connect them together. So what I will do is I will right click, left click over here and I'll right click over here. Okay. As you can see, the size of this is very large. So what we can do is we can double click over here and we can keep the width as 2. So when we do that, now it's coming perfect. Right. And now we can check the DRC errors. So we check. There are no DRC errors or warnings found. Now we'll try to bring this as near as possible. Oh, sorry. Don't do this way. Sorry for that. We have to select the contact, not this layer. Because if you select this and you change this, entire thing is getting changed. So don't do that. Select the contact. The contact is selected like this. This you can bring it near. Okay. Now again, check for the DRC errors. There are no DRC errors. So try bringing it even closer. Yeah. Again, we check it. Yeah, there are no. So I think this is okay. So what we have done so far is we have connected the polysilicons together, the gate materials, and we have connected a contact. We know for a CMOS inverter, let me show it to you in the inverter, the gate terminals of NMOS and PMOS are tied together and input is applied to that. Input port has been applied over there, right? And from the drain terminals, we have connected the output. So that is what we will exactly do now. And the source terminal of PMOS is connected to VDD. The source terminal of NMOS is connected to the ground. So let's continue doing that. So this is my layout so far completed, right? Now we have connected the gate contact also. We have tied the polysilicon layers together. This is the gate terminal and we have established a gate contact. Now next is, we have already brought the polysilicon contact as close as possible. And we have completed this step with no, zero errors, zero DRC errors. Now we'll make the connection for the output node. So we need to connect. This is my, let me expand out. So actually for the PMOS transistor, this is my source and this is my drain. For NMOS transistor also, this is my source and this is my drain. So basically now we have to connect the drain terminal of PMOS with the drain terminal of NMOS. Correct. So connect the drain terminals of both NMOS and PMOS together. So what we will do is we'll right click over here and then we'll left click over here and then we'll right click over here. So automatically the drain terminals are connected with a metal one. That is the light blue color, right? And then we can, bring it out. We can left click and we can right click. So we have brought this out, contact out, correct? So that, visibly we can make this as V out. Fine. So what we have done is we have made the connection for the output node, that is by connecting the drain contact for PMOS and drain contact for NMOS. And we have put this layer metal one a little out over here. So now we'll again check for DRC errors. So there are no DRC errors. Very good. So your layout is free of any DRC. So once we have pressed this, check this DRC, there are no DRC errors now. So it has your layout is passed the DRC test. Now it's time to create the ports. So let me expand it a little. So far this is my CMOS inverter layout, correct? So this is my VDD. Pay attention over here. This is my VDD. This is my PMOS transistor. Its source contact is connected to VDD. Its drain contact is connected to output node. Both their gate terminals are tied together. We have a gate contact. And this is my NMOS transistor. NMOS transistor drain terminal is connected to the output. And the source terminal is connected to the ground. Okay, so we have more or less your 80% of your layout is completed. Now we have to define the ports. Now, what do you mean by ports? Input port, output port. So here we have defined the V in, VDD, V out and ground. Same way we have to define it in the layout also. Okay, so to create the ports, we select the contact, let's say here. Let's say we start with the output port. So we select the contact over here. And let's say we want to make the output node, right? So we select the contact, we'll go to the export and we'll click on create export. So here we have to give the same name. So there we have given the name of V out, capital V out. And export characteristics will be output. Over here output. And then we'll click on OK. So you see that has come onto this V out. So we have exported the output port. Similarly, we'll export the input port. So click over here. And then you click on export, click on create port and give the name over here as V in and select the port as input port and then click on OK. So our V in input port is also added. Now similarly, we'll select the VDD, right? The supply voltage, metal line. So we have selected this, we'll go to export, we'll click on create export and here we'll type VDD, capital VDD. And we'll select year over year as power. Okay, so that is also got selected. In order to increase your found, we can press control plus. So control plus, see their pond has increased. Now what we will do is, now we have to again select the ground port. We have to make the create the port for the ground port. So I selected this and then we go to export. Then we'll click on create export. And then we click on the ground, GND, we have added over there, ground. We select the ground export characteristics and we click on OK. So ground port is also added, fine. So in this manner, we have added the VDD, V out, V in and ground. Similar to what we have done in the schematic over here, right? Let me just push this over here. Yeah, VDD, V in, V out and ground. Just as this, we have added in the schematic, same way we have added into the layout also. So this is my CMOS inverter layout, almost completed. You just check it once more for the any DRC error. So it is having no DRC errors at all. So we have created the input output VDD and ground ports with zero DRC errors. So now we have created the schematic view earlier in the last video. And now today in this, we have created the layout view of the circuit. Fine. So after doing layout of the CMOS inverter and running the DRC, we have made sure that this layout is clean of any design rule violations. But it is very difficult to verify visually whether the connections between the different terminals in the layout it's made or not. Okay. Whereas in the schematic, it's very easy to check the connections, whether they are connected or no, just as you can see with the with these wires. Okay, now this, since it is a simple CMOS inverter, it's very easy to visually analyze in the circuit schematic. But in the layout, it's a little difficult to do that. So what is the solution? So therefore, Electric offers us a tool that verifies the connections between the various components and the terminals in layout with the connections of the schematic. Okay, because they are both the part of the same cell. One is the schematic view and one is the layout view. They should exactly match with each other. So, you know, this tool which Electric offers us to verify the connections in the layout is called as LVS, layout versus schematic. So if your layout passes your LVS, that means that our layout is correct from the connection point of view also, right? And it is exactly matched with the circuit schematic. So that same LVS tool in the Electric is called as NCC. Okay, so we have to go to tools and here you see NCC. So we can click on the first option, schematic and layout view of the cell in the current window, and click over here. Okay, so when you click over here, we will see the message now in the electric messages. So what do you read over here? They have compared the inverter schematic with the inverter layout, and they found out that the exports match, the topologies match, and even the sizes match. Now, what do you mean by exports match? Exports in the sense your V out, V in, VDD, and your ground are correctly exported. And they have checked it, they are matching with the schematic part also. Next is topology. So topologies, that means your NMOS and PMOS, that is also correctly matched. Also the transistor sizing are matching correctly. That is the meaning of the word sizes match also, right? So over here, we can check the sizing of the NMOS and PMOS is width is 10 and the length is 2. Here the, for the NMOS, it's width is 5 and the length is 2 lambda. For PMOS, it was 10 lambda and length was 2 lambda. Similarly, in the layout also, we have defined it such a way. So if the NCC gives you such results, that means that an NCC stands for network consistency check. NCC stands for network consistency check. So that means by the way, wires in schematic are called as interconnects in layout. So after clicking on the NCC, a report has got generated. Okay. So in some cases, what happens is whenever you click on NCC and over here, a report will get generated that exports match, topologies match, but sizes do not, they are not matching or sizes are not even considered and not checked. So what we need to do it in that case is in some cases it happens. So you have to go to preferences. And in the preferences, it's opening up, the window will open. Yeah, in the preferences, you go to the tools and here in NCC, now, there is one option, check transistor sizes. So see to it that this is ticked mark. So if this unchecked, then you have to click on this so that this arrow is, so that this is ticked, right? And then click on OK. And then again, run the NCC check. Then you will get the sizes also match. Once the layout passes your NCC test, that means we are very sure that whatever connections are made on the schematic, right, are perfectly matched with the layout. So all the layout their connections over here with the different components and the terminals are perfect as per the schematic. So that means you both your schematic as well as your layout are in perfect synchronism. They are perfectly symmetric and they're perfectly connected. No problem at all. The exports are matching, technologies are matching, and even the sizes are matching. Now, next thing is, we have to add the SPICE model. Okay, the code which we have over here in the SPICE. This is my, this is the code which we have to add it similarly to the layout also. So how do we do that? We will double click over here and we'll go to edit and we'll click on copy. Okay, we have to include the same files, right? For the layout also, for the CMOS layout also. So we'll go over here and go to edit and click on paste. So as you can see, the exact model card, all the SPICE code has been added over here also in the layout part. So that is what we want. It's coming very small, but when you expand it, you will get to see it's all there. Okay. So now let me again go to Windows and fill window. And so I have almost completed everything now. Correct. So we have added the SPICE deck code on the layout also. Now, last step is after this, your last step is just once check your DRC. Yeah, it's clear. It's clear. Everything is clear. Again, check your NCC. Yeah, all the matches are there. It is matching. Your schematic is matched with layout on the basis of export topologies, and the sizes are also matching. So absolutely no problem over here. Now we are ready to simulate the layout. So for doing the simulation, we have to go to tools, go to SPICE, simulation SPICE, and click on write SPICE deck. So The moment you click on write spice deck, it will take few seconds so that your LT spice will be invoked. Okay, your LT spice will automatically start after a few seconds, maybe around 5 to 10 seconds. It will take to invoke the LT spice. So once the LT spice, here you can see the LT spice window is invoked very, very clearly. And over here, you see that right now I can right click over here, right? Add the trace and add my V in. Okay. So I've added my V in. Next, I will add trace V out. Okay. So this simulation, what we got after simulating the layout is called as post layout simulation. Okay. I again repeat, this simulation, which we have done just now, is called as post layout simulation. Okay. This is a very, very important step. And here you can check the delay. So what you can do is you can go to your view, go to spice error log, and here you see the delay will come. So remember, in the pre-layout simulation also, we have calculated the delay. So here the average delay is coming out to be 21.5 picoseconds. Okay. Whereas the average delay for a pre-layout simulation was somewhat less. The average delay of post-layout simulation is shown over here as 21.5 picoseconds. Okay. So now let me open up a Word document and, paste this thing so that we can compare it finally. Yeah. Okay. So we have opened a Word document and we'll save all the print screens over there. So again, I'll inform you all. Let me repeat this step. I'll again go to the electric. First of all, I have to save this, schematic. So I can take the print screen of this layout and I can attach it over here like this. So you can also attach the full screen like this. Okay. And then next is what we will do is, again, I repeat the step. We'll go to tools for simulation, go to spice, simulation spice, and click on write spice deck. So the moment you do that, your LT spice will be invoked and you'll get this window, right? So here you right click, click on add trace and click on V in, click OK. Next, click on add trace V out and then click on OK. So as you can see, these are the results which are similar to what we have got in post layout, pre layout simulation. So here it is a correct inverter characteristics, because when the input is low, the output is high. And when the output is low, when the input is low, the output is high. And when the input is high, the output is low. Okay, so it's depicting a correct inverter CMOS characteristics. Now, basically what we will do is we'll go to view, we'll go to spice error log. And before doing that, we can take the print screen of this also, so that y'all can have the results over here, correct? We can maximize this part of the waveform and you can do this also. Then next is we go to view and we'll click on the spice error log. So you remember this will directly give us the fault time, rise time, the propagation delay, high to low and low to high, and average delay time. So as you can see, this print screen also you can take so that you can showcase with the post layout simulation, we are getting an average delay of how much? 21.5 picoseconds. Okay. So what we can do is we can copy this out and paste it onto the Word document, and we can write over here post layout simulation results. So then we'll compare our results with the pre-layout simulation. So this is the post-layout simulation results. Let me show it to you. And we will highlight this part because this is very, very important. That is what we are comparing, right? So here we are getting it delay as 21.5 picoseconds. Okay. This is with the post-layout simulation. This is my post layout simulation results, correct? And also one more thing which you see, observe over here when you go to this. Let me close this now. here in the top level cell, this is automatically created, right? So when we did pre-layout simulation, there was only length and width. But now when you do post-layout simulation, you have this AS, which is the area of the source, area of the drain. Then we have periphery of the source and the drain. So these are getting additionally created due to the layout. Actually, a parasitic capacitance and resistance also gets created. But since it is a very simple layout, just with one single transistor of PMOS and one single transistor of NMOS, there isn't any much of your parasitics over here. When we create, two input NAND gate, there definitely you will get your various parameters will get extracted over here. So here, this is the additional thing which is getting created in the top level cell in the form of your SPICE code. Okay, automatically generated. Now, what we will do is we will quickly compare this with the pre-layout simulation. So how to do the pre-layout simulation quickly? I hope that you have done that step. We'll go to the schematic, inverter schematic. We'll go to tools and we'll go to SPICE, simulation SPICE, and write the SPICE deck. So this is the pre-layout simulation. So as you can see in the pre-layout simulation, there is no area of the source or the drain. Nothing is there. Only L and W is there. So you see the difference, saw the difference. Now we'll click over here and add the trace for the V in, and then we'll add the trace for the V out also. I guess last time also you have already done this, right? Just for the proof, we have adding the pre-layout simulation outputs also. So this is pre-layout simulation. Okay. So what you can do is you can directly take the print screen of the output, as well as you can take the print screen of your pre-layout simulation circuit also, schematic also. So this print screen also you can add it once. Okay. In the pre-layout simulation case, if you have not done it last time, you can do that now. Then this is the corresponding output. And then we have to test the, we have to compare the average delay. So we'll go to view, we'll go to SPICE error log. So here it is. As you can see very, very clearly, here the average delay is, you can take this print screen also. So whatever print screens I am taking, y'all can also similarly take it for your own, when you create your own CMOS inverter, right? And then finally, I'll write over here, pre-layout simulations results. So what will come over here? Here, we will add the average delay and all the other timing parameters, okay? So we'll go over here and we'll add the results. The last point is very, very important, the average delay. So when we compare the average delay of a pre-layout simulation of a schematic and a layout, they are different. For a layout, the average delay is around, how much it is? 11.37 picosecond. Okay. The average layout is about 11.37 picoseconds, the average delay, right? So, and with the post-layout simulation, how much is the average delay? Let me paste it from here, so that we can compare it in one screen. Yeah. So here I've added the pre-layout and post-layout simulation results together. So what do you see the comparison over here? It's very, very clear that from the simulation results that the pre-layout simulation results, the average delay was around, 11.37 picoseconds. And we can see now that for the post-layout simulation results, when we make the layout and simulate, the average delay has increased to 21.5 because of the parasitics generated. So you can now appreciate that when you do the various design steps, that is, we start with the schematic circuit of your design, you perform the pre-layout simulation. Even if the pre-layout simulation results match with your delay constraints, what would go wrong? So after doing the layout, what will happen is, your timing check will fail because you see over here with the time, the average delay. So you may not meet the timing requirement of the circuit. Okay. So that is why this custom design is an iterative process. We have to go back, size the transistors, do the corrections, or meet your timing considerations. Okay. So that's why even after doing the post, that's why the importance of pre-layout simulation and the post-layout simulation is there. Now, the advantage of using Electric is it's an open source tool. We can do it without installing any paid softwares, right? We can easily, LTSpice is also open source, right? So we can easily do it in our own, at our own homes, we use in our PCs or in our laptops, right? So this completes the analysis and the comparison between the pre-layout and your post-layout simulation results. And we have successfully completed your CMOS inverter layout in Electric. Okay. If you have any questions, you can refer the video, or if any step you have missed, you can write down in the comment section for any error. Okay. So that's all for from our side, right? So we can try this inverter. You can try this simple inverter circuit, and then you can slowly build your NAND gate, NOR gate comparatively, right? So that's all for today. We'll meet again next time with a new experiment. So until then, have a good day and thank you.